It wasn't until the storm clouds darkened the sky that the residents of Beauregard realized just how devastating the day would be. Lives were lost, homes were destroyed, and the relentless tornado left nothing but devastation in its path, leaving March 3rd of 2019 a day to forever remember. A week before the devastating event, the Storm Prediction Center, or SPC, began to notice the potential for a significant weather event in their Day 8 outlook. However, at that time, they didn't have enough confidence to mark a specific 15% risk area. Despite the growing concerns, they maintained this cautious outlook, refraining from drawing any outlined risk zones until just 3 days before the event. It was then that the SPC highlighted a large 15% risk area covering most of Alabama and Mississippi, along with some states to the west. As the days went by and more data came in, forecasters at the SPC started to gain more confidence that this storm system had the potential to produce several strong tornadoes. Their attention focused on a specific corridor in southern and eastern Alabama, as well as central Georgia. Given the increasing threat, they issued an enhanced risk warning, which is level 3 out of 5 on the severity scale, for those areas. They also expanded the slight risk zone to the east and south as the situation became more concerning. The SPC held on to this enhanced risk through day 1, even extending it in all directions to cover a larger area. In retrospect, this event could have warranted a high-risk classification, but the SPC chose not to issue one at that time. On the morning of the event, the 12th Z surface analysis showed a broad area of low pressure sitting over the Western Carolinas. There was a stationary front, along with a baroclinic zone and a warm front, extending southwestward across north-central Georgia all the way to southeastern Texas. At the same time, a surface low, dragging a powerful cold front, was pushing Arctic air and wintry conditions southward. This entire system was moving northeast, setting up for a severe weather outbreak. Significant CAPE was detected offshore in the SPC's 12Z mesoanalysis. By 18Z, as the front began to lift northward, CAPE values of 1,000 to 2,500 joules per kilogram were observed over inland areas, which is more than enough to fuel severe storms. This high CAPE was paired with strong wind shear in the 0 to 6 kilometer range, about 50 knots, and storm relative helicity values of 300 to 500 meters per second squared, creating an environment ripe for the development of semi-discrete supercells within a squall line. These conditions were highly conducive to producing several strong tornadoes. At 10 a.m. Central Standard Time, the Storm Prediction Center issued a mesoscale convective discussion, noting a 95% chance that a tornado watch would be issued for southern Alabama, southwestern Georgia, and northwestern Florida. The SPC highlighted the potential for a few strong tornadoes in southern Alabama and into west-central Georgia, precisely where this deadly tornado would later strike. Nearly 2 hours after the MCD, the SPC issued a tornado watch for southern Alabama, extending into northwest Florida. Less than an hour later, another tornado watch was issued for a large portion of central Georgia and a small section of the central Florida panhandle. Both of these watches warned that a few tornadoes are likely, with a couple of intense tornadoes possible, and they noted an 80% chance of at least 2 tornadoes and a 50% chance of at least 1 significant tornado rated EF2 or higher. As the cold front continued its march, a squall line of storms developed along it, with semi-discrete supercells embedded within the line. Discrete supercells were also noted on radar in southern Georgia, along with another developing supercell over Alabama, which would later produce the deadly tornado. Significant tornado parameters, which measure the likelihood of strong tornadoes, increased along the line where this supercell was forming, consistently reaching levels of 3 to 4. An increase in storm relative helicity to 600 also contributed to the growing tornado threat. All these factors together heightened the tornado potential in the area, and exactly 1 hour before the tornado touched down, the SPC issued another MCD. They noted that both Scheer and Cape were at their peak and that strong tornado development was likely within the next 30 to 60 minutes. The atmosphere continued to become more conducive to tornado formation, and at 2 p.m. Central Standard Time, the tornado made landfall near Society Hill, Alabama, setting off a tragic sequence of events. The tornado's destructive journey began just southwest of Rogers Road and northeast of U.S. Highway 80 in northeast Macon County. At first, the damage was relatively minor, with only small limbs being snapped off trees and a few pine trees being uprooted. However, as the tornado moved eastward, it gained strength. It crossed Callaway Baker Road and Glassy Mill Road, where it began to uproot more pine trees. As the tornado continued east, it crossed Macon County Highway 43, where it uprooted additional pine trees before crossing the county line into southwest Lee County. Upon reaching Lee County Road 29, the tornado's strength grew. It ripped the roof off a church, nearly collapsing a quarter of the cinder block walls, and continued to uproot trees. The tornado moved north due east, crossing Lee County Road 11. Here, it peeled back sheet metal from the porch of a home, tore metal off two outdoor storage sheds, and uprooted more pine trees. Debris from structures and their contents was scattered along a tree line to the east of their original locations, with some evidence of weak ground scouring along the tornado's path. The tornado reached its peak intensity near the intersection of Lee County Road 36 and Lee County Road 39. In this area, it rolled a manufactured home, spilling its contents nearby. On the southern side of the tornado's path, a house was completely destroyed, with all the debris tossed a short distance from the foundation. The tornado bent the frame of a car around the remnants of a large tree, broke off the upper portion, and destroyed three vehicles by slamming them into the bases of two remaining tree stubs. Further to the east, on the other side of a small lake, a well-anchored, well-constructed home was leveled, with all debris removed from the foundation, leaving only intact anchor bolts. Toward the northern edge of the tornado's path, two double-wide and a single-wide manufactured home were completely destroyed. As the tornado continued its eastward path, its intensity began to decrease, though it remained highly destructive. It roughly paralleled Lee County Road 39, where it destroyed two more manufactured homes, scattering most of the debris away from their original locations. The metal frames of the mobile homes were so badly damaged that they couldn't be located. Another manufactured home was destroyed, with its contents strewn across a swath leading into the remnants of a nearby tree line. A car was found overturned against a tree stripped of most of its limbs, with a mattress from a bed wrapped around the mid-portion of the tree. The mangled metal frame of a manufactured home, along with nearby debris, was all that remained of one residence. In the vicinity, a tractor-trailer rig was overturned and shoved against a tree, while a nearby site-built home lost nearly all of its exterior walls, with debris scattered around or near the home site. Severe tree destruction continued in this area, with trees snapped at their bases and uprooted. To the north of Lee County Road 39, significant debris was deposited in a wooded area where the tornado caused extensive timber damage and toppled at least one high-tension power line tower visible in the near distance. After demolishing two double-wide and a single-wide manufactured home, the tornado moved northeast, crossing Lee County Road 51 just north of the intersection with Lee County Road 39. Here, a double-wide manufactured home was moved off its base, and the exterior walls of a family residence collapsed. Tree damage continued, with more trees snapped at their bases. As the tornado moved further east, it began to weaken slightly. It crossed Lee County Road 38, where it deposited a large amount of debris into a forested area that had already been heavily damaged. The tornado continued its northeastward track, crossing Lee County Road 100 and Lee County Road 166, where it caused more tree damage, snapping some trunks and uprooting others. The tornado's destruction persisted as it moved along Lee County Road 165 and portions of Lee County Road 40 and Lee County Road 2049. It collapsed the exterior walls of a family residence, removed most of the roof from another house, and caused significant roof damage to both a house and a manufactured home. The tornado then flipped a manufactured home, scattering its contents nearby, destroyed the roof and walls of a single wide manufactured home, and continued to cause tree damage. The tornado moved eastward across Lee County Road 170, then veered slightly to the northeast, crossing Lee County Road 401 near the intersection with Lee County Road 175. It continued to inflict damage on homes and timber as it made its way to Lee County Road 241. The tornado maintained its northeastward trajectory, crossing Lee County Road 245 and Lee County Road 179. It damaged the roof of a house along County Road 239, continued to wreak havoc on the area's timber, then turned more to the east as it approached Phoenix City from the west, crossing Lee County Road 239 and portions of Lee County Roads 246, 289, 292, and 290. Along this path, it caused roof damage to a house and continued to damage timber. As the tornado approached the Fuller's Lake area, it rolled a manufactured home and caused some roof damage to a nearby house. Additional damage occurred along Lee County Roads 294 and 298, where a professional building lost some of its roofing materials and several poorly constructed small homes suffered damage to their siding and roofs. When the tornado crossed the U.S. Highway 280, it caused roof damage to a restaurant, damaged a billboard, and collapsed a cellular communications tower. Northeast of U.S. Highway 280, along Lee County Road 298, the tornado caused significant timber damage. It then shifted slightly to the right, affecting areas along Lee County Roads 300 and 319, where more homes suffered roof damage and extensive timber damage was observed. A tree fell and crushed an outbuilding, while a single wide manufactured home lost portions of its roof. The tornado continued its northeastward march toward the Chattahoochee River, causing roof damage to some houses near the river and downing a metal high-tension power line tower. After crossing the Chattahoochee River, the tornado continued to produce extensive damage in Georgia. 23 lives were tragically lost due to this single devastating tornado. Among the victims were 4 children. 10 members of one family alone were lost in this catastrophic event. The East Alabama Medical Center received 60 patients, though by March 4th, only 4 remained hospitalized, as others had been treated and released. The chaos of the situation initially left many people unaccounted for. In the desperate search for survivors, drones equipped with heat-seeking technology were deployed, scouring the area from above, while ground crews had to wait for daylight on March 4th to safely resume their efforts. Thankfully, by March 6th, it was reported that all tornado victims in Alabama had been accounted for. Let me know what you think about the Beauregard tornado, and if you haven't already, make sure to subscribe and click the bell icon to enable notifications.